Welcome. This is your host, Heidi Watson, on Two Tier Canada, the podcast where we explore the ups and downs of private practice in a diverse network of health professionals. Hello, and thanks for listening to the podcast today. Today we have Michelle Schmidt with us. Michelle is a registered massage therapist with her own well-developed practice here in Weyburn, Saskatchewan, where she was born and raised. But massage therapy is not where she started her career. Initially, she was a physiotherapy assistant. Michelle attended the Medicine Hat College PTA program and worked as a physiotherapist assistant, helping many people with various conditions. Eventually, she moved to Drayton Valley to a new PTA position with more responsibilities, but reached the end of her practice scope. So after a few years, this really left her wanting more. And so she thought about her different options and started to lean towards physiotherapy, but was actually drawn into massage therapy. Again, returning to Medicine Hat College, the massage therapy program there offers the students work at the same time. So Michelle got to see the various settings that she could use her new training in and decided in the end, after she finished her program, to return home to Weyburn and start her own private practice here. After reaching out to a local clinic, she found a place to rent and has grown her practice significantly over the years, and I'll let her explain how she did it.
So I've already done your introduction. We've already done the bio and background. We have Michelle here in person today, so the audio quality should probably be a little bit better, but you might hear a baby in the background on occasion, and that's just the way it is. And so I guess our first question that we'll start out with Michelle, is what do you love about your profession?
I like the fact that it can be as busy as I want it to be, or as slow-paced as it needs to be to accommodate my family life as well. I just really enjoy being able to help people. There's something very satisfying about being a part of their care, that they let you in to be part of their care, because sometimes it can be a rather difficult scenario that they're of circumstances they're coming to see you with. Mm-hmm. On that particular day or for that particular injury. And there's sometimes lots of things that they don't always share the first time. So the fact you can build a rapport over a series of treatments, and that they will let you kind of into their space a little bit, mm-hmm. it's quite rewarding.
That people kind of feedback that you get. So do you keep your practice pretty busy, or would you say you keep your practice rather easygoing?
I'd like it to be busy. I'm probably at about 80% full capacity right now, with some personal issues that I had going on last year that I wasn't able to work full time for a good part of the year. Now those conditions are gone. I'm feeling much, much more healthy, and I would really like to get back to that full capacity. But at the same time, 80% has been roughly a good number, because now I can have the ability to have walk-ins where in the past I wasn't able to.
Oh, okay.
At the one place I worked at, the private spa, once I got established, I was booked for months in advance, which might sound amazing, and it is, to kind of have a bit of the guarantee of having a real, you know, 9 to 5, Monday to Friday job. But it really was difficult when you had to be sick. Your family member, you know, your child is sick, you have to take the time off. Where do you put these people?
Right.
They're booking specifically, you know, an after work appointment. They're booking long time, weeks to months in advance, to ensure they get that
spot.
5:30 time or 6-7 o'clock time. Uh-huh. And now where do you put them?
Right.
So this does allow for a little bit more flexibility. Those after work hours are still fairly in demand and still fairly booked in advance, but mm-hmm. now folks are starting to realize, well, I can come at noon. It's okay. I can come over lunch.
Yeah.
You know, grab an hour of sick time or personal leave time and then get away from work.
Do you find then that your practice is very much in the evenings? Like, or do you have enough daytime clients?
I would say there is still sort of a subtle push towards an evening. Mm-hmm. And I have to be very careful that I'm not allowing that push to start consuming my time, because I do have my own family at home and I'd like to be able to spend the evenings with them.
Mm-hmm.
So because my little guy's at school all day, I get home at 7 o'clock and bedtime's
pretty
at 8.
Close to bed.
So,
yeah.
But when things are not as full as they could be from the first thing in the morning, the 9 o'clock, it could be that you just have to work the evening, because you need that so many people per day to make, you know, as for your budget for your bills and such. So
right.
You just have to make it work.
Right. Do you work on the weekends then, or not at all? Like, is where did you draw the lines for your practice? Like, for that life balance?
I usually do one Saturday a month.
Oh, okay.
And when it's coming close to Christmas time or maybe holiday time, I might bump in a second Saturday just to kind of help plug myself for when I'm away. But it's usually just Monday to Friday, 9 to about 5:30.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And Wednesday, Thursdays, usually I tend to take an extra person in the evening because there wasn't anything going on with my son's activities those two nights in the past.
Yep.
So I thought, and Thursday night, historically around where we live, is Thursday night shopping. So there's people out and about Thursday evenings. And I thought, well, this way you can accommodate two nights that you work a little bit later, and then there isn't that push to stay late Monday, Tuesday, Friday.
Right.
Especially on a Friday. No one wants to work late on a Friday.
No, no. But everybody wants a massage on a Friday.
That's true. that doesn't wait.
Do you give yourself a set number of vacations, like vacation days, or do you just kind of take vacations as you feel you need it?
Good question. There should be something more set in stone. I'm not incorporated, so I'm not large enough a business to incorporate that way, which would be, you know, the good thing with that could be you're paying yourself to be off on those. You get your 3 weeks or 4 weeks, whatever you set the business model up. But this way too, it gives me the flexibility. If in past years, in the summer times, I wouldn't work a Friday.
Yep.
So it didn't matter whether my husband was off at the same time, I just wouldn't work Fridays. So it made it a little easier as far as babysitters were concerned. The one gal we always had in the past played ball. She's a competitive fastball player. So Fridays they were usually going to tournaments. So it always just worked out great. And then usually in August time, the month of August, we wouldn't have a sitter some of the time. So I would just go to work when my husband came home. I would start. So I would be there from 4 o'clock till 9:30, quarter to 10 at night. Never had a problem filling those time spots.
No.
Especially after supper.
Yes.
Even in the summertime, there was always people that were willing to come. So, but for the most part, I do try to, I am trying to get better. Even though I've been in doing this now for 10, 11 years or so, you still have the opportunity of being pushed, and kind of your priorities don't get to the forefront. I'll just do it this way for this time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, just 2 weeks, I'll do it this way, and 2 weeks can add to a month, and then 2 months, and
it just kind of slides out of control.
It can snowball for sure.
Because they're people, right? And you develop relationships with them, like you mentioned, and they, you know what they need. And
if they do happen to call, I mean, someone who's come to see me for a long time, they say, you know, I'm sorry to ask this. I'm really in a bind. I did whatever. Can you please see me even for half an hour?
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard to say no, because they've been a very faithful and good customer for all this time.
Exactly.
And you, it's not like you're going to lose them, but you know the ones that won't abuse that
and they need
emergency
it. They
policy
really do.
And they really need it. They come hobbling through the door and you go, oh, yeah, okay. I'm glad I said yes to you today.
Yes, you're very broken. So you kind of were mentioning about your family. What else has your business played a role in with your family dynamic, like the good and the bad?
Well, the potential for working the long hours plays into that, where you don't get to spend a lot of time at night with them. But also the fact that I can be flexible. If my son ends up having something at school, I can shift people around. I can work late one night to accommodate a morning activity, or vice versa to an afternoon activity. There's ways that I can definitely work around people. And if they just say, I offer, you know, an evening time especially, oh yeah, I'll be there for sure. Or work an extra Saturday or something like that to accommodate what
he
has
going
on.
For like a field trip or something.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense.
And if it's something else that's different, well, I try to rely on my spouse to take some time off because he is at a regular job that gets guaranteed sets of vacation. And so if I really need him to, if there's just no way that I can get away from work because of whatever might be coming up, then I can rely on him to take the time off.
That give and take kind of thing.
Do
you ever feel trapped in your business or anything like that?
I don't think so. I really like the fact that it can be, right now I'm seeing a lot of outpatients. In the past, I have gone to the hospital, our acute care hospital, treated folks in hospital. I've gone to their homes. If they're, a client who I've seen for a while, well, my mom is having trouble and she's not really mobile. Would you consider going? I'll pay for your mileage to go. So those rare occasions, I have made exceptions to go to a person's home. Just recently, actually in the fall, I'd started, I was trying to figure out a different way to get some new clientele. I've had some folks move away. And again, like I was saying, when I was off on my personal medical leave last year, you lose some folks because they make other arrangements for their care and you can't fault them for that. So I was discovering that I had these gaps in my,
in your schedule.
So I decided I'm going to make a corporate proposal. So I sent out to a couple of businesses and I am now at a business 2 Fridays a month. And they do the bookings for me. I'm set up in a room and they are very keen to it. I'm full every time slot that I'm there.
That's really neat. So you have a portable table that you take to these sorts of things, or?
I have a portable massage chair that I take. And that way then it could be able to be portable to fit if I was in a tiny room.
Right.
I'm in effect in an old unused boardroom. So I have
a whole big space.
It's bigger than my clinic room actually. And so I get a lot of space in there and they are just so keen to have, I think they thought it was just a Christmas initiative. And kept wondering, when am I leaving? I said, I'm not going anywhere. I'm booked 2 Fridays a month till June. Maybe take a break over summer for vacations, of course. I said, as long as you guys want me, I'm here. And that way too, it helped. I've already gained several people coming now to my private practice, which was the hope that I would get. And if they needed to take time off, certain departments aren't as flexible, but if they needed to take time off, their managers would then have a bit of a rapport knowing I'm coming into their business and saying, you know, it's okay, yeah, take an hour of sick time and go.
Yeah.
I think in the past, that might be something that was a hindrance to employees to ask. They weren't, didn't have, you know, physical, I'm sick symptoms, but
sore,
you
achy.
need to take into account going to a practitioner like myself. It's a medical reason.
Yeah.
You're not there to get kind of fluff done. You're going for a particular condition and you want employers to feel that they're being good and being proactive and letting the employees come, whether it's massage or chiro, physio, acupuncture.
It's preventative care, kind of like a repetitive strain. You don't want to let it get to the point where you can't even function anymore. And now you're on a worker's comp where it could have just been a couple hours on a Friday when you have this special massage therapist come in.
That's right. And you're taking sick time constantly, which then certain companies have policies on that. And you know, you end up going to a doctor and you're wasting their time getting a letter. Well, yeah, I'm sick because I'm getting migraines at work due to whatever. My workspace isn't set up appropriately. I don't have the right, you know, at that point, then they've got to allow, you know, certain other professions like occupational therapists to come in and do an assessment of the workplace.
Yeah.
And determine what can be changed or what are we going to have to work around.
Yeah.
So, you know, letting other professions come into existing workplaces, I think, is such a benefit. And it just really helps, I think, the employees feel that, well, the bosses do care about me. And this is great that they're having this come in. So I'm hoping that's the response. I've heard nothing but positive things. And I let them know, you know, be honest, tell me if there's something that we need to change or improve. And I haven't heard any complaints thus far. So
yeah, you're not, the client is now a bigger organization rather than just that individual person.
That's right.
So like for the nitty gritty, do you still have the client pay and they put it through their benefits, or is there a relationship where the employer can actually cover that? Like, how did you set up that kind of piece?
Well, I approached it with the employers stating that I would be willing to be open to either one.
Oh, okay.
And they just felt that it would be better if the client, if their employee just paid, and then they would submit
Process
themselves.
The
like I said earlier, I'm not incorporated to a larger incorporated business, so I don't have access to online billing. And quite frankly, nor do I want kind of that hassle. I just prefer that the client, my client, take care of that with their workplace themselves.
Yeah.
I'd rather just stay out of that. If it was an issue of, you know, their case system being audited and they just need to phone and confirm, the insurance company would phone and say, was so-and-so here? Yeah. Okay, good. Thank you. That's all we needed.
Yeah.
That's about as much as I want to do with their being involved in
third
their
party
personal.
Payer.
That's right. So they've been very good about it, and they just know to bring money on the day, and
mm-hmm.
I have receipts ready, and it's
just quick and
it's
easy.
It's just quick and easy. Yeah.
And local.
Yes. Yes. They were very excited, and so it makes me kind of encouraged that maybe I can, you know, depending on how many others I get responses from, maybe that'd be something to include to a couple other businesses with
mm-hmm.
a large amount of employees. Like this company I'm seeing, they have over 100 employees.
Right.
So it makes sense to go.
Yeah. It's not just an office with six or
yeah.
something like that.
Yeah. And not saying that they're any less important,
but
it has to be feasible for me to be away from my regular clinic where...
To book an entire day.
That's
mm-hmm.
right.
So why don't you tell us a little bit more about the clinic that you work in and how your business structure is there?
Okay. I'm currently now working out of a high performance training center. So I am seeing anyone from a range of office worker to youth hockey player, you know, prospects, all kinds of athletes from different sports, and as well as just, you know, regular working Joes. So the variety is still quite nice, and I think it really helps to make me use all of the skills that I have.
Right.
And they've been very good to me there. It's just a really nice place to work in. We recently moved locations a year ago, January.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm really enjoying the new space. For me personally, what I work in is a really nice workspace.
Yeah. Did you get to like design it during the move or that kind of thing? Or
they approached me when I said I would still stay on and come and move with them. And they said, you get a pick of your office, you can pick your paint color.
Ooh.
So the offices were all roughly the same size,
uh-huh.
you know, give or take a square foot here or there. But so I picked my paint color, and they had the flooring colors that they wanted throughout to get, you know, the better bang for their renovation buck.
Uh-huh.
And it worked out really well. Anything that I picked has gone really nice in there. And a lot of my clients have really commented that they like this room better than the old facility we were at. Just nice to have it fresh and updated.
Yes. Yeah. Just a little bit of a change of pace kind of thing.
Absolutely.
What else was I going to ask about the clinic? What sort of arrangement do you have with them? Is it a kind of contract or a rental agreement?
It's a month-to-month rental agreement. So if there's anything that ever changed with my situation, kind of like living in an apartment, give a month's notice.
Yep.
Just to be fair. And but with along that, I get, you know, some perks being there. It's a gym, so a training facility, so I mean I get discounts on, you know, clothing, supplements, month membership, that kind of thing. So there is an incentive to try and make me healthy, keep me healthy, keep me working for them.
Yes.
As or rather alongside of them, as well as me trying to promote that to my own clients too.
And then that's why you have the walk-ins too now.
That's right.
It's because of that kind of structure rather than having your own storefront.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess you could still have walk-ins then, but you definitely would have walk-ins at a gym.
Mm-hmm. Somebody, unfortunately, somebody always ends up, well, I did this maneuver and I have to kind of furrow my brow and go, what did you do? So let's go to the back, show me what you did. And
mm-hmm.
then I can try and see, you know, where they have moved improperly. And you know, sometimes it's a matter too that they've trained so long and they just sort of lose that body awareness. So to have a third eye kind of watch in and do what they're doing, saying, well, why are you doing it this way? So that's been kind of a neat, it kind of brings in somewhat of my physio background.
Definitely.
Where we were monitoring, you know, workers' compensation clients and motor vehicle clients in their post rehab, or I say post rehab, but work conditioning rehab, where the pain management was somewhat under control, and then transitioning them to some light duties
mm-hmm.
before, you know, transitioning them into like a work hardening where it's really simulating daytime hours and tasks. So,
but then having to stop them before they get bad movement
habits.
That's
right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so that's been kind of fun to kind of still have the physio part to pick out now and then too. So
definitely.
Yeah.
And then just be able to march into the back and be like, what did you do?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if you had a different clinic without that blend, then you kind of have to describe and rely on that.
And if
report.
I wanted to show them something too, there's an empty space on the floor, you throw mats down and say, yeah, this is the stretch I want you to do for back or hips. Or
yeah.
If I don't really have enough room in my own office, we'll just let's go to the back.
Yeah.
So I really enjoy that I have the freedom to utilize their facility too as part of my treatment.
And then even for in the community and community awareness, people see you then
mm-hmm.
and they see you showing these stretches, and that's good for business
mm-hmm.
as well, because then it's like, oh, she helps with more than just I'm going to do the massage.
Yeah. She's just not rubbing somebody's back or neck. She's
yeah.
actually teaching them something to, you know, not hurt themselves again or to prevent
mm-hmm.
something else from happening.
So what other tricks do you have? What other courses have you taken and that kind of stuff?
I have taken, apart from just the basic, the 2-year diploma course that I obtained at Medicine Hat College, little plug, they've left it up in our last semester of school. Basically, that last semester was sort of a week of modules just to kind of introduce us to the various paths. And we only touched on whatever that 6-7 weeks of that last semester was, kind of one modality per week.
Uh-huh.
There are so many things out there. I've really enjoyed gravitating towards the cranial sacral part of therapy. I really enjoy the less is more approach.
Uh-huh.
And I always kind of thought, you know, maybe 20, 30 years down the road, maybe my hands may not be able to tolerate this deep tissue work as much anymore.
Yes.
So that was a way to kind of, you know, still be in the treatment mode, but doing a different, very different approach to the technique. I have also last year recently completed a manual lymph activation course and taught by Heidi herself here. And I have used it in some practice. Generally, we were discussing dealing with people that were post-cancer treatments
mm-hmm.
through our course, but definitely where it's indicated to do different work, use it to treat different conditions. And that's where I kind of came in. I've had people come in with severe muscle tears that you're helping drain lymph out of a limb and
mm-hmm.
using the taping to get that
swelling
activation
to go down.
Going. Yeah. And that's been very effective. I was actually just approached last week by a lady who is about to start her chemotherapy.
Oh, okay.
And her radiation. So she was asking me some questions and I was asking her questions.
Uh-huh.
And she said, well, when I'm ready, I guess I know where to come. I said, I'll be here.
Yep.
So good luck with your course of everything and try and stay healthy. And
mm-hmm.
definitely, you know, look me up when you're ready. So that's good. I get the chance to kind of go back and dust off some of the
lymph drainage
specific for cancer, post-cancer.
Mm-hmm.
Without, of course, with someone not having cancer, there wasn't really a lot of contraindications of
exactly.
what to do, and you could do a lot more. But I'm looking forward to getting a chance to work with a client with that condition head on. So,
mm-hmm. And lymph drainage and craniosacral, like, those are big specialties.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, they're a very, like, targeted group of people that can be treated with both of those.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any other specialty courses that you've taken over the years, or...?
They've kind of somewhat morphed into a little bit of this, a little bit of that. There has been definitely learning more about myofascial releases.
Mm-hmm.
And within that, there's, you know, active release, rapid release. There's all different trademark modalities within.
Mm-hmm.
So when we were in school, we did learn bits and pieces of each of those. So I've always just kind of utilized some of those techniques.
Mm-hmm.
At some point, I would really like to, I think, get into an active or rapid release technique. The therapist who I see has done that with me, and albeit as very uncomfortable as it can be, because I'm kind of, you know,
might work with your hands.
It might work with my hands, and yes, and shoulders and back and everything.
Uh-huh.
So some of those areas take a bit of a beating that we, as body workers, lose track of too. So
uh-huh.
that kind of, you definitely feel that immediately after, but it is a fairly intense treatment,
mm-hmm.
but it's very effective too. So I would like to maybe search that out this year
mm-hmm.
and try and find some courses close by, hopefully Regina, Saskatoon would be something a little bit close. Now that I have a family, it's hard to get away and make those kinds of commitments work.
You're not flying across the world anymore for courses.
No, that's right. You have to pull it back a bit now.
Be a little bit closer.
That's right.
So where, what other directions were you thinking for taking your business? Do you have any other courses or dreams of taking it?
There are so many avenues to kind of pursue with that. When you go online and look at different treatment modalities, you kind of think, wow, that would be awesome, or that would be awesome. But I really would like to study further in depth the cranial sacral for sure.
Uh-huh.
The opportunity to be able to work with infants is something very exciting for me. I'm a bit a ways from that level yet, but I would like to continue to work toward that level.
Uh-huh.
I've really seen where it can be very effective. Anything too that I can continue working with my lymphatic drainage work. Now that when I was in school, I really struggled with the practical application. I just didn't have the depth of touch right. And with our course, I mean, you know, when you were telling, there was another massage therapist there, and I and Heidi had to keep telling us lighter. We were getting really grabby. So that was
it's
something.
Just a massage therapist thing.
That's right. It's just in our nature. We can't help it. But it definitely was a nice change to the approach, where you really had to switch gears in your brain to just turn off what you know. You don't turn off how you know it. You just kind of turn off what you know and try something a little different. So
mm-hmm.
that would be...
And that's hard after practicing a certain way for so long and then trying to change those gears. And that's also why continuing competency stuff is so important,
mm-hmm.
because you don't just get stuck in that one groove forever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it would be very boring to just do that over and over and over,
uh-huh.
and same treatment over and over. And your clients aren't going to eventually like that either. You know,
yep.
they'll tend to gravitate towards someone who...
shakes it up a bit.
That's right. So you have to kind of keep it fresh and updated
mm-hmm.
for yourself and for your clients.
Yeah, definitely. How did you end up going into private?
I think that was very much taught to us when we were in massage school. With it being right in Medicine Hat, the one hotel there had a really big spa associated with it, so you were an employee. So there were opportunities where you could be an employee as well as be on your own.
Mm-hmm.
And I just kind of thought, you know, the reason why I kind of changed gears to leave physio when I was looking to move, I wanted to have that ability to have the flexibility in my schedule. So I was willing to take a chance and just say, no, I'm the boss. I want to do it my way.
Yeah.
And I want to be in control of how I book, how many I book, those kinds of things. So they seem like small things, but they are quite important. I went back as an older student. I wasn't just out of high school, you know, 18, 19 year old. So I'd been around the block and kind of, you know,
been in the
worked
workplace.
In the systems, you know, and I just realized that I think this is for me. This is the avenue for me.
Mm-hmm.
And so I wanted to be able to have that flexibility to take it where I wanted it to go.
Exactly.
And to change gears like I did just in last fall, the ability to say, well, I'm going to do an extension to corporate and I'll see if I get a bite. And I did. So, you know, I'm excited that I'm able to have that flexibility to just, I'm going to do this, or
we're
I'm going to do
change.
That. Yeah.
And move over.
I'm not just going to stay stagnant and keep doing what I'm doing. So,
mm-hmm. Did you find that there was anything that held you back at all? Anything that you were kind of things like benefits, guaranteed hours, guaranteed salary, that kind of things? Did you have anything that kind of was a bit of a resistance?
I did when I first started at the day spa. Of course, you're brand new, even though I'm from town here,
mm-hmm.
but you're brand new in that job market. So it took a little bit to gain some clientele,
uh-huh.
and I really relied on a lot of word of mouth. I had a good relationship with my chiropractor, who was gracious enough to take my cards, and my family doctor, who took and gave out my cards, and
uh-huh.
you know, friends of my parents and my own friends. I basically blew a whole first box of business cards just handing them out to people to
yeah.
say, pass around, please.
Yeah, get them out.
So, and yes, I mean, there is the ability to go and get extended benefits for myself. It is a touchy walk because you can turn around. I'm now on my husband's plan, of course, which is great.
Mm-hmm.
But when I first started, I was still single, so it's a bit of a gamble. You have to.
Do I want to pay into this? Mm-hmm. Do I not want to pay into this?
Do you have to get
this?
Your own extended health benefits? And
uh-huh.
So when we were together, it just made sense to drop my own personal one. And I was established by then, so I knew I wasn't giving up kind of that guarantee of a health benefit. So
right.
That would be probably the only thing I think when you're starting out new is, you know, there's a lot of startup expenses that you don't think about.
Mm-hmm.
You might be healthy
now
to start with, but and that would be the time to start looking at, you know, like a Blue Cross or a personal
mm-hmm.
Health benefit system that you can get on board with, you know, before anything major happens to
disability,
you know.
Critical illness.
That's
like
right.
They're really important to get at some point.
Because our livelihood is our hands. I mean, if you're gonna
uh-huh.
do a different, you know, say as an example, you go and work in a bar on the weekends for a little extra cash,
uh-huh.
or that's what you did as, you know,
in
some part time job going to school, you know, you have to think about that. There is a risk you could get cut now
mm-hmm.
when you're there. So you have to think about those kinds of extracurricular activities that you have to be smarter about what you engage in so that you're not putting yourself at risk if you don't have that coverage.
Yeah, because how are you going to practice if you can't use your hands?
That's right.
Have you changed your business model at all? Like, do you have a model that you follow? Do you have any, or do you just kind of go with the flow?
I think in the recent past, I kind of just went with the flow. But as things have happened, as I've gotten a little bit older, I really had to start to rethink the wheel, so to speak.
Uh-huh.
And so I'm trying to keep things new. I'm trying to keep that flexibility to have walk-ins where I didn't have the time before. And it's not that those folks aren't important, but I just didn't have the time to accommodate that. And now that I can, so that it is, you know, we talked a little bit earlier about that go with the flow thing.
Yeah.
My personality isn't very much to go with the flow. I'm kind of, I need structure.
Scheduling.
And so I'm finding maybe as I'm getting older, I'm mellowing a little bit and I'm thinking it's okay. You can kind of
mm-hmm.
just see where it takes you, or you have to be able to say, well, okay, I guess today's an example, 2 clients.
Yeah.
Nobody wanted to book a Tuesday.
Yeah.
So every day this week, I'm crazy busy.
Except for
today. So, I mean, that's just, in the past, I would have freaked out and thought, what am I doing wrong?
Or...
So now I kind of just think, well, I mean, I will go to the back and say, I've got an opening right now. Anybody wants it?
Yeah.
If there's some of my clients that are back working out, where are you in your program? I had a no-show. Do you want to come?
Hey.
So that maybe is one thing that has changed. You'd asked about different business model. When I started, I didn't have a policy regarding lateness or no-shows.
Oh.
So maybe I should talk about that a little
bit.
You really have to establish that in a service
right away.
Job right away when you're starting your private practice, because it's very easy for clients to just, oh, well, I forgot. Genuinely, yes, that happens. You know, sometimes you get too much going in your brain, and
uh-huh.
it is an absolute honest mistake. But there are those that will abuse it. And well, I just forgot. Oh, I went to Regina for the day, or I went here or there.
Yeah.
Well, in the meantime, you're out that money.
Yeah.
And I think the assumption is when you're kind of a business within a business, that way renting a space, that somehow you are employed by
the
large business, and you're not. You're on your own. So that empty hour and a half, you've missed out. And that's important that clients know that, you know, our time is important too.
Mm-hmm.
If they happen to have to cancel due to illness or, you know, child illness or something very short notice and sudden, of course you can make exceptions, but you really do have to establish a policy
mm-hmm.
to put that down in writing and not be afraid to do it as a brand new person starting.
Yeah.
You put it out there. My personal policy is if they're late, they're treated for the remainder of the time only, and they pay the full amount.
Mm-hmm.
I guess, have a thing set in stone whether I say 24-hour notice. If it's somebody new that I've never seen before, I don't know where they're from, I want 24-hour notice because There's no relationship to form that yet. Mm-hmm. They haven't been in to see my posters on the wall regarding my, you know, my policy. Yeah. And if they're late, as I said with it, sorry, I'm repeating myself. If they're late, that's what happens. If they no show, I now have it on my intake form. The very first time they see me, I have read the late policy, I have read the no show policy mm-hmm. on the back and signed it. So I used to kind of give the one time
warning,
freebie warning,
yeah,
and I don't anymore because it was just taken advantage of.
Exactly. And like you talked about at the beginning about loyalty and relationship with clients and mm-hmm. stuff like that. And if you don't put that kind of policy in place and you don't say anything when people are constantly late or constantly no-show, you are attracting a certain type of client.
That's right.
And you'll continue to keep those types of clients, and then these things will haunt you for your whole practice.
That's right.
And so if you are relatively firm, then you don't get walked on.
That's right. And it's okay to establish that directness mm-hmm. right off the bat.
Yeah.
I think that might be the tendency, especially if you're young, starting your brand new practice, that you don't want to shoot yourself in the foot, so to speak. You don't want to tick off those clients that you want them in so bad. You want to build your clientele.
That you'll bend all the way over backwards.
You'll do anything for them. Yeah. And that's just... That was something a colleague friend of mine who's a therapist in town told me very early on. And trust me, at that time, when I came back here, I was 37, 36, old enough to know better.
Uh-oh.
And, you know, those words came back to haunt me later, just to say, have boundaries. If you don't have your established boundaries / policies, it's like you just said, it will haunt you forever. And mm-hmm. her words finally kind of gave me the proverbial smack upside the head and said, you just have to sit down and come up with something that's concrete, but that's fair
yeah.
for everyone. And don't be afraid to display it. Don't be afraid to put it out there. So when I mm-hmm. did a revamp of my intake form, I decided, yeah, that's going on the back. When yeah. they read the consent that allows me to treat them, that kind of thing, my scope of practice, what I will do, what I won't do, and then that's right underneath those two sentences that I have read the above policy. I have mm-hmm. read the above policy. So I just thought that's just the better way to do it right from the start. They know your limits.
Do you take your forms to a lawyer, or did you base them off of forms that you found online or from a colleague? Like, how did you set those up when you first did it?
I more or less took the forms that we used at school. Which our coordinator said, definitely, you can make them as detailed or as simplified as you wish. And you are more than any form that we had there for exercises or that kind of thing. She just said, go ahead and, you know, take
That's
a copy
really
of
good
each
that
one.
They cover that.
That's right. Because she said, you got to have something established. And sometimes when mm-hmm. you're, you know, back then you're buying things online. Well, everything is an expense and you have to kind of learn to dial it back at some point.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean you won't, you know, do an online billing or soap notes or anything in the future,
yeah,
but it's something at least to get you started.
Right.
So currently I just took it was a long 4-page double form. It was quite long and thorough, and I just kind of modified it now to a 2-page. I don't have it notarized or anything like that,
And it's what you need.
It's just what I need.
And it's a flexible form and you can change it as you need and that kind of stuff.
If it was more than one of us working, if I say had the overall business and then I decided to sublet and employ mm-hmm. two people to come in and I just was the overseer, well, then you'd have to set something a little more legal-wise, I would tend to think. I would have to check with my association on that. But I think it would just be covering your bases to do it that way.
Mm-hmm. And so, other people have maybe different specialties that would have to be covered on the
that's
forms
right.
and stuff.
Yeah.
So
everybody might come in with some different
angles
so,
that they go for.
That's right.
Let's see. What haven't we covered yet? What would you have told yourself when you were just starting out? What would you have changed, if you would change anything at all?
I would think probably what we kind of touched on, just setting that boundary.
Right.
Don't be afraid to go with the flow. You know, don't be afraid to just say, I'm going to have a day of walk-ins today. I'm not going to schedule.
Just a quick interruption here. Two-Tier Canada has been brought to you by the Electronic Health Information System, an electronic health record made specifically for private practitioners. Check out our demo at e-his.ca. Now, let's get back to this month's interview. Sorry, we had to take a quick break there. So we were just talking about what you would have told yourself when you were just starting out. Mm-hmm.
I think, again, like, just to have those boundaries to say you've just got to be firm with what you want to do so that the people just don't kind of walk all over you. Mm-hmm. And it's not always an intentional thing. It just kind of happens because you are so willing to do anything to build that clientele.
Right.
Don't kind of sell yourself short to get there. It'll happen. You do good work. Your name will get out there. And, mm-hmm. you know, word of mouth is a really powerful tool. And as long as you stick to what your scope of practice is, you shouldn't have any problem. But definitely utilize other therapists if you run into trouble. When I moved back here, I utilized our physiotherapist who I worked with when I was still a physio assistant. I would phone her a lot. Hi, Angie. Send this blip out to you. And she was very helpful at, if I ran into a problem, what did you test? Well, I tested this and this. Well, what did you find? Well, that and that. And sometimes you just get so, I think anybody can get sort of blindsided to just saying, well, this is what I'm thinking it is. Well, you didn't leave yourself open to the possibility. So don't be afraid to go out and get, you know, colleagues. If you don't know any when you move to a city, make them. Go introduce yourself to chiros, to physiotherapists, to other massage therapists, and just say, hey, you know, would it be all right if maybe we met? Uh-huh. You can either have an informal group meeting or maybe take the reins and formulate sort of a practitioner's group within your community.
Right.
That's maybe a good tool to start it off. And then you'll always have somebody there that you can rely on if you have a question.
Is it kind of a personality piece of it too? Like, do you find that if somebody was really, really shy, it would be hard for them to be in private practice?
I think there's a chance that they would probably be a little difficult. Not saying that they wouldn't do a good job working with their client once they got hands-on on the table.
Uh-huh.
But you have to be comfortable asking those kind of deeper questions when it comes to terms with what have they done? What have they done in the past? If you don't understand something,
uh-huh.
you know, write it down, look it up after.
Right.
Or just say to the client too, you know, I'm not really sure what this is. Would you mind if I contacted a colleague and just discussed this with them? So you might have to separate a form out for that. But you have to be willing to ask those
sorts of
questions. And in any, I think, accredited massage school program, you are taking a communications class that's going fairly in-depth to explain. In Ed Medicine Hat, ours was done primarily by the nursing program,
uh-huh.
but you're taught how to do those primary, secondary, and kind of those deep delving questions. You uh-huh. have to get to the bottom of what that person is coming to see you for that
day.
So it's important that you're comfortable using terminology and comfortable sometimes talking about, you know, potentially a rather intimate subject.
Right.
And it could be an issue of abuse. And, you know, you have uh-huh. to kind of have those things ready. You know, you might need to start formulating a relationship with perhaps your public health, mental health folks as well,
mm-hmm.
in case you come across that as a scenario. So
right. Do you have like any sort of safety things in place if somebody, like, because that it can be quite emotional if something like that mind-body connection.
That's right.
And things can come out on the table.
Mm-hmm.
And so do you have things in place for that?
I've let the client know, you know, number one, it's a safe place to express that emotion, whatever mm-hmm. it is. Do you want me to stay in the room? Would you prefer I left and you know, dealt with this on your own? And 9 times out of 10, they want you to stay. They don't want you to interject. You just say, I'm here to listen if you want. That's
yeah.
all I can offer. But if they are really struggling, I mean, I would definitely suggest, is there someone you want me to call? Can I call a family member? I always let them know if something were to come out on the table, and I wait until they're
ready,
perfectly ready to leave the clinic. And I always let them know, I'll phone you tonight and I'll phone you in the morning, just to let them know that they didn't just sort of potentially spill the proverbial beans. And then, well, now I'm embarrassed. Well, you don't have to be, because I'm just there to make sure you're okay. Do you need any service? You know,
mm-hmm. and continuing that therapeutic relationship.
That's right.
And making them comfortable. Like, that's huge.
Very much so.
Do you ever feel alone in your practice, like practicing solo? Or like, if somebody has that sort of, like, how do you let off that steam after that?
I think when I first came back, because I had worked in a physio clinic, a therapeutic clinic before as a physio assistant, we had two physio assistants, two occupational assistants, an occupational therapist, three or four physiotherapists. You were kind of not alone. You always had someone to bounce that off of. So I think when I kind of got up and going, I didn't have any qualms about phoning a colleague and saying, I need a little bit of guidance here.
Right.
But I think if someone were brand new, and again, maybe not in their own community, they might feel that bit of shyness, but you got to just go for it. You've got to go make those connections yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So I've enjoyed somewhat of that solitude, but it can be a little lonely at times too.
Uh-huh.
But I think if you're able to get into a networking group, whether you start one or you join one, if one is already established, I'm sure every one of those workers has had the same kind of feeling when they started out.
Yeah.
And maybe too, as they've developed along, maybe they've been in a practice where they started out with multiple therapists or other body workers in their midst, and then due to, you know, retiring or moving or having families, now they're the only one.
Mm-hmm.
So it can kind of go from the opposite end of that too, where you were used to working with many and now it's just you.
Now a few.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think it's just important that you just take charge of yourself and go and make as many connections as you can.
Right. And it's so nice now with technology, we can reach out to people that aren't anywhere close to where we are.
Mm-hmm.
And like reaching out to school colleagues, old work colleagues, and that kind of stuff, right? You're not literally, we live kind of rural Saskatchewan.
Yeah, we do. Well,
not a ton of people.
We both worked with one physical therapist who now is back home in Namibia.
Uh-huh.
I have emailed her and gotten her advice on a couple of clients that I just kind of thought, what am I missing? What am I not testing? And she was very kind enough to be that support person when she was still working here in Weyburn. And I just thought, that relationship doesn't have to end.
Right.
I'm just going to Facebook her and I'm going to get her email and I can set it out. So, I mean, that was a great tool just
to
be able
to reach across the world.
That's right. That's right. And same with the other therapist. Well, she's in New Brunswick.
Uh-huh.
I email her too on occasion. So I haven't lost that contact with them either.
Those connections.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then keeping those connections is just so, so important.
Mm-hmm.
And so keeping up your local connections, keeping up other professional connect works, it's just really important.
If you have that connection too with, you know, your coordinator or some teachers at your previous school, you know, I don't think there's been any case where someone hasn't said, can I phone you if I have trouble? I'm pretty sure none of them would say no.
Right.
You know what I mean? It doesn't matter. I don't think it matters what school you went to. You know, you may have had a... They're the best ones that know how you studied for that period of time and how you learned through that period of time. So I'm pretty sure they can probably pull the memory out and go, oh yeah, you had trouble with that. So I think I can help you figure this problem out. So just don't be afraid to utilize everybody you can.
Yeah, because you don't have to know everything all the time.
No.
And
it's okay to research
it,
you know, and to say, I'll find out for you, you know, and just, I'll have an answer for you next time you come, or I'll phone you tomorrow and I'll tell you what I found out.
Right.
It is okay to say that, I'm sorry. It's rather better to say, I don't know, than to fluff your way through it.
You're right.
You know, you don't want to give bad advice.
Exactly. Exactly.
So it is okay to say, I have to research that a little more. I'm not quite sure.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't show incompetence, I don't think, in my opinion. It shows that I'm going to do some diligence and do some research for you, and I'll figure it out, and I'll let you know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And it just continues that professionalism.
Absolutely.
Is there anything else that you would want to tell the listeners, any advice that you would want to give if they were starting out a massage therapy practice?
I would just say, enjoy it. Enjoy the freedom that this type of job gives you.
Mm-hmm.
Don't be afraid to try new avenues. Just because maybe somebody else tried it and it didn't work doesn't mean it won't work for you. And definitely always keep in contact. Don't be afraid to talk. Always try and figure out that group of people that you can bounce the ideas off of. Even if you were wanting to find something in your practice and you're not really sure whether it's worked for somebody else, doesn't mean you follow that advice, but you can certainly listen to it from other folks and you know, if they're willing to work with you, maybe they can give you a hint of how you need to approach it. So they can give you all kinds of advice, not just on clients, but on your business as well.
Well, thank you for chatting with me today.
You're
it's
welcome.
Been really valuable, and I'm excited to get this podcast out there. Yeah, any final thoughts?
No, I think it's been fun. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Big thank you to Michelle for allowing me to interview her today, and thank you to you for listening to the podcast. Please subscribe to the podcast on whatever you're listening to, and leave us a review or comment. We would love to hear from you and to see how we can improve the podcast and make it better and more relevant to what you need to hear. Also, come back next month for our next one. We've lined up an amazing clinician who runs a multidisciplinary practice and has worked very hard over the years to build it up, and it is the go-to in Saskatoon now for pediatric care. Hope to hear from you, and we'll talk to you next month.